Bless that wonderful name of Jesus. Oh, bless that wonderful name of Jesus. Oh, bless that wonderful name of Jesus. No other name I know. There is power in the name of Jesus.
When Paul and his companions had passed through Amphipolis and Apollonia, they came to Thessalonica, where there was a Jewish synagogue. As was his custom, Paul went into the synagogue, and on three Sabbath days he reasoned with them from the scriptures, explaining and proving that the Messiah had to suffer and rise from the dead.
"This Jesus I am proclaiming to you is the Messiah,"
he said. Some of the Jews were persuaded and joined Paul and Silas, as did a large number of God-fearing Greeks and not a few prominent women. But other Jews were jealous, so they rounded up some bad characters from the marketplace, formed a mob, and started a riot in the city. They rushed to Jason's house in search of Paul and Silas in order to bring them out to the crowd. But when they did not find them, they dragged Jason and some other believers before the city officials, shouting,
"These men who have caused trouble all over the world have now come here, and Jason has welcomed them into his house. They are all defying Caesar's decrees, saying that there is another king, one called Jesus."
When they heard this, the crowd and the city officials were thrown into turmoil. Then they made Jason and the others post bond and let them go. As soon as it was night, the believers sent Paul and Silas away to Berea. On arriving there, they went to the Jewish synagogue. Now the Berean Jews were of more noble character than those in Thessalonica, for they received the message with great eagerness and examined the scriptures every day to see if what Paul said was true. Many of them believed, as did also a number of prominent Greek women and many Greek men. But when the Jews in Thessalonica learned that Paul was preaching the word of God at Berea, some of them went there too, agitating the crowds and stirring them up. The believers immediately sent Paul to the coast, but Silas and Timothy stayed at Berea. Those who escorted Paul brought him to Athens and then left with instructions for Silas and Timothy to join him as soon as possible. While Paul was waiting for them in Athens, he was greatly distressed to see that the city was full of idols. So he reasoned in the synagogue with both Jews and God-fearing Greeks, as well as in the marketplace day by day with those who happened to be there. A group of Epicurean and Stoic philosophers began to debate with him. Some of them asked,
"What is this babbler trying to say?"
Others remarked,
"He seems to be advocating foreign gods."
They said this because Paul was preaching the good news about Jesus and the resurrection. Then they took him and brought him to a meeting of the Areopagus, where they said to him,
"May we know what this new teaching is that you are presenting? You are bringing some strange ideas to our ears, and we would like to know what they mean."
All the Athenians and the foreigners who lived there spent their time doing nothing but talking about and listening to the latest ideas. Paul then stood up in the meeting of the Areopagus and said,
"People of Athens, I see that in every way you are very religious. For as I walked around and looked carefully at your objects of worship, I even found an altar with this inscription, 'To an unknown God.' So, you are ignorant of the very thing you worship. And this is what I am going to proclaim to you. The God who made the world and everything in it is the Lord of heaven and earth, and does not live in temples built by hands. And he is not served by human hands, as if he needed anything. Rather, he himself gives everyone life and breath and everything else. From one man he made all the nations, that they should inhabit the whole earth. And he marked out their appointed times in history and the boundaries of their lands. God did this so that they would seek him, and perhaps reach out for him and find him, though he is not far from any one of us. For in him we live and move and have our being. As some of your own poets have said, we are his offspring. Therefore, since we are God's offspring, we should not think that the divine being is like gold or silver or stone, an image made by human design and skill. In the past, God overlooked such ignorance. But now he commands all people everywhere to repent. For he has set a day when he will judge the world with justice by the man he has appointed. He has given proof of this to everyone by raising him from the dead."
When they heard about the resurrection of the dead, some of them sneered, but others said,
"We want to hear you again on this subject."
At that, Paul left the council. Some of the people became followers of Paul and believed. Among them was Dionysius, a member of the Areopagus, also a woman named Damaris, and a number of others.
Ask me how I'm doing, I'm blessed, yes. Living every moment, no regrets. Smile up on my face, I'm like, oh, yes, I'm blessed, yes, I'm blessed, yes. Waking up, thanking God. Every day is feeling just like Sunday. Wifey fly by my side. Green light, everything is going my way. Riding clean, living dreams. Just left the barber and I'm feeling like Midas. Heard him say, give him praise. What's in the water got you acting like this? Ain't a day gone by that I don't try to thank the Lord up above. And if you wonder why I'm loving life, come close and I tell you what's up. Ask me how I'm doing, I'm blessed, yes. Living every moment, no regrets. Smile up on my face, I'm like, oh, yes, I'm blessed. Yes, I'm blessed, yes. Ask me how I'm doing, I'm blessed, yes. Living every moment, no regrets. Smile up on my face, I'm like, oh, yes, I'm blessed. Yes, I'm blessed, yes. Playing cards, laughing hard. Barbecuing, waking up the whole block. Music loud, turning out, little kids are breaking out the bus stop. Life is good, really good, and every moment, no, I can't forget. I gotta say, I won't change. You're the reason that I am like this. Ain't a day go by that I don't try to thank the Lord up above. And if you wonder why I'm loving life, come close and I'll tell you what's up. Ask me how I'm doing, I'm blessed, yes. Living every moment, no regrets. Smile up on my face, I'm like, oh, yes, I'm blessed, yes, I'm blessed, yes. Ask me how I'm doing, I'm blessed, yes. Living every moment, no regrets. Smile up on my face, I'm like, oh, yes, I'm blessed, yes, I'm blessed, yes, I'm blessed. I'm blessed, I'm blessed, I'm blessed. I'm blessed, I'm blessed, I'm blessed. Your family fed. Oh, 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 you're blessed. Sunshine, I'm so free. Living now my dreams. God's been good to me. Oh, 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 I'm blessed. Yes, living every moment, no regrets. No regrets. Smile on my face, I'm like, oh, yes, yeah. I'm blessed. I'm blessed. Yes, I'm blessed. I'm blessed.
God is good.
Yes,
living every and all the time. I agree with that statement.
Yes, I'm blessed. Yes, I'm blessed. Yes, I'm blessed.
But I don't think we feel that all the time.
I'm blessed. I'm blessed. I'm blessed. I'm blessed.
And so one of the most frustrating things about life is it is not favorably reliable. A, on your handout, life is a contradiction. That's not the answer, but you might want to write this down somewhere. Life is a contradiction. Life is a contradiction. Life is a contradiction. It is. We live a life of contradiction. If you are a contradiction, welcome to the family. Life is a contradiction. What do you mean? Life is, and this is the answer, life is consistently inconsistent. It's a contradiction. It is consistently inconsistent. It is reliably unreliable. Second answer. It is reliably unreliable. You can rely on life to not be reliable. The only thing consistent about life is that it is completely inconsistent. People die and people live. And I swear the people die need to live, and some of the people living need to die. Now, listen, don't be looking at me crazy. Some of y'all done felt that. You have seen people die, and you like, but what about them, though? Right? Because you got about 17 candidates. Life is reliably unreliable. Number two, life has the ability to turn. It has the ability to turn without question, permission, or apology. Life has the ability to turn without question, permission, or apology. Have you ever been living life and life took a turn on you? Like you were going in this direction, you lined up everything, you were headed down this road. You had counted everything. You had counted your eggs before they hatched. This was supposed to happen. That was supposed to come in. This was supposed to do this. You had this all planned out. You were executing your plan. You did this. You saved your money. You went to school. You did all of the stuff. And yet and still, in the middle of it all, life just went and started going in a completely different direction. Life can take a turn, and it takes a turn without permission. It doesn't ask your permission. It doesn't issue you an apology either. Life never says, I'm sorry, but I gotta go this way. It doesn't give you a warning. It just happens. The degree of turn, lastly, the degree, or second to lastly, the degree of turn is sometimes called a tragedy. There you go. The degree of turn is sometimes called a tragedy. You could be going this direction and life can take a turn. A tragedy is an event causing great suffering, destruction, and distress. Causing great suffering, destruction, and distress. Suffering, destruction, distress. Suffering, destruction, distress. Suffering. Your current condition that you are in and experiencing emotionally, suffering, or physically. Destruction, your world. Your world. It's not what it used to be. And distress, worrying about sort of the difference between what was and what now is, distressing over what will be. There's sort of a difficult dissonance between what was. We're used to what was, but then what was is not what is. And I don't like what is, because what is wasn't what was. Because I knew what was. And I was used to what was, and I figured out how to handle what was. But now what was is now what is, and what is not what was. And I'm wondering, will what is ever revert back to what was? So what will be, will what will be ever become what was? Because if what will be will not become what was, I'm completely distressed, because I have no idea what will be if it's not what was, because I've never seen what will be. And at some point I get frustrated, because what will be needs to get here sooner than later, because no matter what, I'm sure enough tired of what is.